So, it's 5 minutes past 12 or 1, depending on the time zone where we are. I would propose that we start with the overall tutorial. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the tutorial Variability Realization in UML SysML Models, with the undertitle some maybe do's and don'ts in variant handling in UML. We do this the second time, so we already did it last time at SPLC, and we had also some similar presentations also in different other contexts. So actively involved in the preparation of the tutorial is on one hand side myself. I'm Martin Becker. I'm heading the Embedded Systems Engineering Department at Fraunhofer IESE. And today with us is also Andreas Schäfer. He's one of our systems engineers. In my department, in addition, Florian Baldorf was involved in the preparation of the material, also a staff member of mine, and some part of the tutorial basis also on material which was created in a master thesis by Florian Rolf at TU Kaiserslautern. So all of you, we all give you a warm welcome, and it's really nice to have you here. Of course, it would be even nicer if you would have some additional participants, but let's see, maybe some more will join in later on. So what to expect? This is the overall structure of the tutorial. So first we will have an introduction round and collect some expectations and also experiences. Then I want to explain a bit why we at IESE work with this respective problem, also show some or give some more insights on related projects and some examples. And then we want to dive deeper into different variant management approaches which could be followed in UML SysML models to open a bit, let's say, the design space for the things you could do. And then we want to consider also that variability management in UML SysML models at a certain point of time is maybe already challenging, but over time, if there are changes, then of course the whole situation gets a bit more complicated. And finally, we want to have some guidelines, which approach maybe should be followed under which constraints. And we'll close with a short wrap up. Maybe to set a bit the scene, if we talk about variability management, then there is this separation of concerns with these four different areas. And as part of SPLC, there's a lot of work ongoing in the, let's say, problem space in the modeling world, where we talk about feature or variability models and product configurations. But today we will talk about more on the artifacts, so on the maybe solution space. So we will talk about models in Enterprise Architect, in other modeling languages or other modeling tools where we can model UML SysML models, and where we are faced or facing with respective variation points, and where we have to understand how to do this, let's say, in a suitable manner. So we will not talk about how to model variability or how to model features and their interdependencies in UML SysML. It's more about, let's say, if I'm talking in an architecture, logical decompositions of the architecture, for instance, and end up with variation points there, how to handle this best. Good, intended audience. In the ideal case, we would have also some industrial practitioners. Last year, we had several of them. That was quite nice, which then also shared a bit their experience. Let's say, if they have some kind of challenges there and how to do this best. I think this year we have at least one, since also Yua is, let's say, working in an industrial context. And then there are also maybe participants from academia which of course can also share their experience on respective approaches, related work, and maybe also what they do as part of their own research in the field. So in the ED case, we would have this mixture. Let's see, currently the number of participants is still limited. So where we are, our learning objectives were that the participants understand what are drivers and challenges in the field of model-based systems and software engineering. So why is this topic becoming maybe more relevant in industry? That we have a common understanding what are variability management approaches for realizing variation points in UML SysML models. Understand maybe also require tool capabilities, so what would be good to have. And maybe get some guides on how to select suitable variation management practices and technology. And the idea of the tutorial was also to build a kind of community in here where people maybe know each other from maybe different companies or from research, and that they could start to discuss related challenges. So that were our objectives. And the tutorial style is, of course, we will present lots of slides, but we will try to keep it also as interactive as possible and also be directional. To this end, we also thought how we can involve you in the discussion and in the, let's say, in the revision of the slide material what we have. This I will explain on one of the next slides, how we will do this. And I hope you have an exciting time in here, good discussions, also maybe some good inspirations on how maybe to do something in research or in industry. Of course, it should not be a one-directional flow of information here. So we are also learning what's already there and learning about, let's say, best practices. So I would really see it would be an added value if we have the community somehow build it and then try to push this topic forward, since we think it's already relevant in industry and most probably it will become even more relevant. We hope also that you enjoy the time here as part of the tutorial. So Andreas and I spent some effort in preparing the material, but we hope also that we have good discussion as maybe last year, so that you at the end say, okay, that was worth in participating, that thing. Maybe in the general interaction in the tutorial, it would be good if you mute your microphone if you're not talking, maybe to save bandwidth, also stop the video in the interactive parts. It would be good if you have a question on the slide where we are currently presenting, directly raise it. And then if there is a short answer, we will answer it. If there is a long answer, we maybe will put it into our backlog and then come back later to it. It would be really highly appreciated if you can provide helpful comments to the stuff. So as mentioned, we do not consider that everything is the, let's say, the full truth or the holy grail what we present in here. So you could help to improve the things also. And please be active in the interactive parts. For the interactive parts, we did the following. We created a Miro board. I'm not sure if I pronounced it the right way. You will find it here on that link. It should be open to everyone who has the link. And the password is vm@mbse! With that, you should be able to join in there. And maybe first question among the participants, have you already had some experiences with Miro, or is this a new thing to you?
New thing to me.
Okay, then I will have maybe a quick explanation on how it works. So where is my So the Miro is like some distributed whiteboard system. So we prepared some whiteboards. You now see my screen, right? And I see that some of you already have dialed in, which is good. So we have created some whiteboards on different topics. Then you see there are some sticky notes what we already placed. You can click on it, and if you start typing, you will add respective text there. That should be, let's say, sufficient for most of the things we are doing today. We have a set of interaction things what you would like to do together. So the idea is that let's say, quickly introduce yourself. What's your name? Where you are working with? And the next thing was that we maybe get a bit your expectations. So what would you like to learn as part of this tutorial? So if you want to express this, simply grab one of the sticky notes, start typing, and then we would see where you are. Okay, you are already adding information, very good. Here on this introduction board, we structured it a bit. Are you more working in research and in industry? Are you more an expert or more novice on this topic, MBSE in general and reliability management? So I would assume that Juha is on the industry side, and he has definitely also strong experience in MBSE. So I think that's already good enough. I would have expected maybe if you can move yourself into the upper right corner, that also would be fine with me. Okay, yeah, that seems to work quite well. To be honest, as we have that small number of participants, you could also use the time that you quickly introduce yourself. I was assuming that we maybe have 20 participants, and with that, it maybe takes too long. So if you can open your microphone and simply quickly introduce yourself, that would be nice. Meanwhile, I give you maybe an overview on okay, who wants to say something?
Well, okay, you want, sorry, go first.
Oh, this is Juha-Pekka Tolvanen from Metacase. I work for the industry in which we provide modeling tools. We try to build domain-specific tools so that the language handles variation, but we have been also working with companies like Volvo and Fiat, who have built their own meta models, a little bit like SysML, and then extended that with feature modeling and variability modeling and linking. So my particular interest is learning here how and which kind of linking you find with variability with languages like SysML and UML, and how to do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, can I go next? My name is Monica Pinto from the University of Malaga. We have been working for a few years now about connecting feature models and software architectures. And so this is my main interest in this tutorial, to see another approach to do something that I think it has point in common what we have been done. And also now we are working on applying variability models to emerging systems like IoT or edge computing system, and to see how variability model need to be extended to cope with the requirements of these new systems.
Okay, very good. It's great to have you here. Kazuma, can you also introduce yourself?
Hello, I'm Kazuma Fukumoto. I'm currently working at Toyota. And my working field is variation control for autonomous driving. And yeah, we have a lot of variation and we are struggling to control that. So this time I want to learn how to manage kind of the things.
Okay, very good. Oh, so it's we have a fairly strong industry participants in the tutorial. So let's say this is quite nice. Maybe before I dive or come back to the slides, as I'm already there. So in this interactive lane here, we will have, let's say, dedicated whiteboards where we address some questions during the presentation. Then there's below the backlog. So if we have a question which would take too long to discuss it, while the presentation is ongoing, we would add respective input there. And then if you are new to Miro, you could have a look at this Miro introduction board, where there are also some helpful shortcuts. For instance, how do you duplicate a sticky note or such kind of thing. And below you find all the slides, what we are going to show on the board. There would be also the request from our side, if you have comments or would say, okay, this is unclear to me, or would be great to have more information here and there, simply grab one of these sticky notes from the left side, drag it on the respective slide, add your note, so that we later on can come back and share then the respective material. Good. So this is what we have in there. So for us, it would be good if you, in the expectation, could add your key expectations also on, let's say, some sticky notes there, that we can come back in the end and check if we have touched everything. That would be great. Yeah, for the other ones besides Juha, it would be great if you could also locate yourself somewhere on the board in here to explain a bit who has actually participated, if you don't mind. Good. Are there some doubts regarding the usage of Miro? We will anyway come back later on. So maybe if you can try a bit while I'm filling or talking about the next slides, that would be great. Good. Then I will continue, let's say, with the presentation. So regarding the introduction, we already did that. You placed your name already. And please add also regarding your expectations, the key things. As a kind of disclaimer at this point of time, in this tutorial, we will use Enterprise Architect as a modeling tool and also Pure Variance as a variability management tool where suitable. With this, we do not want to express a recommendation for this tool combination or for this tool at all. It's just that we used this tool combination in a project which has paid for the creation of the example models. And therefore we use it also in here. It would be great as part of the tutorial that at the different sections, you could also bring in your experience with maybe related tools, other SysML, UML modeling tools, or in the case of Juha, maybe also experiences how you do it in Metacase. Yeah? So, I don't want to raise the impression that the things what we present in here just works in Enterprise Architect and Pure Variance. We used it just as one tool combination to the respective models in here. Later on, after the tutorial, you will also get the tutorial slides. If you want, you simply send an email to either Andreas or myself. The access to Miro board will remain. So you dare already see the slides, but if you want to have them in PDF, which is then easier to handle, just drop us a mail and then we can do that. Good, regarding the timing, This is the official timing. I added also our time zone, since I was assuming that maybe here and there you will see also my time at our side. I have to admit, I have a small issue in the end, since I have to attend a meeting on short-term notice from 4 to 4:30, which would be the last half hour. There would be a quite easy way to fix this in that sense if, let's say, either Andreas does the finalization on his own, or the other thing would be that we do the break a bit earlier. Then while I'm in my meeting from 4 to 4:30, you have to break, and then we come back maybe for half an hour, wrap up, and some discussion. This, of course, depends a bit if you want to participate in that last session here by Maurice Terbeek and others. So the question would be, would it be fine for you if we do it as set, so that we have a break from 4 to 4:30? And then come back at 4:30, maybe for half an hour to close the training here. Or does this cause some problems at your side? If there are some things which causes some inconvenience, then it would be clear that we stick with the original schedule. Let's maybe decide this later on. Okay, let's go to this motivating examples, so to say, from the real world projects. I will be quite fast on that. If you have any doubts, please let me know. So Andreas and I, we are working for Fraunhofer IESE. So we support industry with applied research and technology transfer in the field of software and systems engineering. So IESE is located in Kaiserslautern in Germany. And the original topic was more a software engineering institute. In recent years, we to some extent extended this also a bit and cover also some system engineering topics. One topic which is quite old at the institute, so to say the product line or reuse, topic. This really started more than 20 years ago. So I think the first PULSE report that was on our PULSE methodology, how to engineer product lines, this came up in 97. And then we iterated over this. These days, we still help companies in order to improve, let's say, reuse related activities. We sometimes call it also variation management, so tackling with changes in space and also in time. And we do there some tool-based analysis, some scoping, some improvement of product line architectures and stuff like that. So I will come back on this later on. And there are also some companies where we did projects in the past and still are doing that. And this is also the context where this the whole thing here originated. So we are working with some companies or organizations in different, let's say, areas of the business. And they try to use more model-based approaches on software or on system level. And here I try to show a bit an overview in our project, what we saw. So regarding modeling languages, some UML, SysML, some specializations for military, for instance, and then tool-wise, enterprise architect, Rhapsody, also some open source things like Capella, and also regarding methods, different modeling methods, so to say. We are not fixed to one tool, one language, or one methodology. So since typically it's a situation, you go there to a customer, they already have some things in place, and then it's more the question how to do it better than how to completely start anew. And what we saw in there in, let's say, different application domains is that the number or that companies more and more use modeling in order to manage somehow the complexity in their problems. And if you now have different variants or versions over time, then it's also the question how to handle these necessary changes in the modeling languages and not just, let's say, in source code or in the requirements. And in order to do so, also as part of this tutorial here, we want to help you get a kind of understanding where variability shows up in the model, how can we maybe realize it, can be implemented. And as an example, we use UML SysML models. And what our idea here is that we at the end want to provide guidance to industrial practitioners or also some research folks in understanding what is the problem, understanding also what are possible ways to do it and to get a way ahead. So the trend, what we see, what I already mentioned is we have some overall increase of complexity and more companies then start to use some model-based engineering on system or on software level. Handling this in one point of time for one variant is already quite tricky. Yeah, how to interconnect all these different things from the system level, different perspectives down to the disciplines. And now if variants come in, then it becomes even more complicated. And what we somehow see once we discuss also with industrial practitioners are questions like how to reuse model content between different system variants, or how to understand differences between model variants easily. Yeah, it's quite well supported, let's say, to do a diff merge on text. How is the situation there in models? Can we synchronize or transfer changes between model variants? And how to realize maybe changes in models for the different system variants and versions best? Shall we follow, an annotation-based approach? Or shall we maybe modularize the models and reuse libraries, to name just some approaches? These then often are questions. And the impression so far was maybe, the companies we were talking to were not too mature, let's call it like that, on this, but the impression was that model modularization, so how do we organize the model in terms of, some packages and their interrelations, and also lifecycle management in the model is often lacking. They are focusing more on how to interconnect things. And then once changes come in, it starts to become more problematic or unclear how to do it. And for me, when I heard that I thought in the software engineering community, we had this at the early 70s or late 60s, which was called the software engineering crisis, where we had large monoliths and where then engineers were suffering and where then later on the work from Parnas and others helped that with organizing the things in clear modules with clear interdependencies, life gets easier. And what I was wondering, isn't there the risk that if we don't address these questions in here in a sound manner, that we at the end are somehow heading maybe a kind of MBSE crisis, since we invest in large scale models, but if we do not do very well in managing the different variants and the necessary changes, in space between the variants or over time, then there's most probably a big change. On this slide, we want to raise a bit, why are companies maybe thinking to do more on some model-based systems and software engineering. And let's say the common driver is typically the increasing complexity. So there are more functions, more interfaces, more interdependencies, and just keeping this in documents alone would be not sufficient. So the different engineering disciplines, from the requirements via the architectures on different levels, want to interrelate respective work items, so to say, in the models and make the interdependencies clear. And then we have these days an increasing number also of distributed and specialized systems. We have systems of systems where we maybe have a model of one system and a model of another system, and that needs to be combined. Then as software is becoming more relevant, we see also shorter development cycles, increasing number of variants, increasing number of requirements, and also that more organizations are involved in realizing these different systems. So there's simply also the need for a better communication. And all of these things, to some extent, can be addressed with more sophisticated modeling. What is a driver? What we see, let's say in our context, since we do also some projects in the automotive domain, is, for instance, one driver there is automotive spies. So where the OEMs ask their suppliers to follow an automotive spies compliant development process, so to say. And in there, we have models on at least two levels. So the software architectural design and the system architectural design. While software is often some UML-like thing, the system architecture design is something in SysML. And this often asks or drives companies who maybe before had a good understanding of the requirements and maybe good understanding of the source code, really to start building and providing and tracing respective architectural models. And this is also where we're seeing that there is lots of unclarity on the one hand side what to model for the single system, but if there are several variants or several versions over time, how to do this best. Yeah, and that was also the driver on how to do this. I will use the term variation management in this tutorial and want to briefly explain what we understand, under this. So the key challenge is that we have to handle changes in product portfolios. And this change can happen if we at a certain point of time have different variants. So we must understand how the variants differ at some points of time. And the other thing is if I have a product variant or a single product and I see how it evolves over time, then I have different versions. And as we understood, let's say it's not just variability management which matters in here at the end. It's about how to handle and manage changes in the product portfolios in a consistent manner. Therefore, we use this term variation management as the combination, so to say, of lifecycle management, so changes over time, in combination with the variant or variability management, which happens typically at a certain point of time. Good. What did we see in industry? Let's say on the one hand side, there are companies which have some variant intensive portfolios. So several product variants need to be supported at the point of time. This is especially in automotive the case. They have some product lines or platforms, the suppliers, and from there they want to derive their respective customized variants to the higher level. We see this, let's say, in automotive quite broadly. So it's not just engine control, but also for the other involved subsystems and modules that we see that some platform-based or product line-based approaches are followed. So depending on the number of variants a company has to manage, we on the one hand side could see those who use features, feature models to control explicitly realized variation points in there. If the number of variants is lower, or if we are in an application domain, which is maybe not that is not that mature, so they are more at the beginning, then we often see that companies maybe have some first understanding of features and how they do the influence, but they maybe do not invest that much in, let's say, following a 150% approach for the variation points in the models. In the end, companies along this dimension, they have to understand the impact of features in the different variants and have to handle that. A motivator for this tutorial in here was a tutorial at SPLC 2019 from Aito Ayera, who was talking about variability modeling and management in MATLAB Simulink models, where he explained different mechanisms, how to handle the variability, so the necessary changes in the models. And that was also quite inspiring, where I thought, okay, in our context, we were using more UML, SysML, but the overall mechanisms, they are somehow the same. So why not to provide something here, a dedicated tutorial also for MATLAB and for SysML and UML. Then in the same year, I was attending a systems engineering congress in Germany, and there the companies ZF together with some consultancy company showed a slide set where they were talking about feature-based product line engineering. So the idea was that they have one system level model in SysML, and in there they identified changes between the different product variants, and they handled it with a tool. In that case, it was Pure Variants, and the model itself was done in Cameo. And the perceived challenges there, what they mentioned, was, for instance, a removal of functions from the architecture. That's quite hard, or already quite hard to handle, or if input arrives via different paths in the system. So on the one hand side, you maybe get it directly from a sensor, on the other side, maybe in some parts of the systems, you maybe somehow calculate it. With that, the flow inside of the system is maybe different. And they said that was already a bit challenge, and also parameterization. And when I saw this, that was also the point, okay, what are the recommendations there? What a company could use, how, in which situation to use which kind of mechanism? And I asked this guy also there, since they were doing this for a while, if they have such guidelines, and then they said, no, not really. And that was also the point where we said, okay, then it would maybe make sense to think a bit about what or how can companies handle the necessary changes, and can we give some kind of guidances how to do this best? Maybe skip this one. Then there is also another case where we talk about maybe more change intensive systems. So we have one, maybe a large system, which is evolved over time. So there are different versions of it, and maybe not necessarily product variants, but different versions. And now features are added at different releases, maybe also by different organizations. Then it's the question, what is the feature evolution over time? Who has added what, when? And of course, if you have one model, then you would see the current state, but it's often then also the question, how was this model changed, let's say, against the previous versions? And what were the drivers for the changes, maybe in terms of features, and what is the change? Where did the features cause necessary changes? And often also a linear stream of model versions did not work out that well. A setting where we are personally feeling this challenge is a larger scale project in German military, where we have different, let's say, teams which work together on a larger scale enterprise architect model, and they add features in there, so to say. And then it's the question, how can they do this working in parallel on new features, integrating it on the main branch, so to say. So there we also, one of our contributions is here figuring out how the parallel elicitation and documentation of requirements in the architecture could work in independent teams. Then how can we do bring it together, let's say on the main line, and how can we synchronize this, since, let's say, on the text level, this is fairly well understood in source code, but in models, since the things typically are more intertwined and interconnected, it's a bit harder. So that's a kind of challenge there. Good. With this, I would like to come back shortly to Miro and check with you what your experiences and challenges are. So have you made similar or other challenges or experiences? Do you also would agree that model-based approaches become more relevant? Is it clear at your side how to handle these variations or the changes best? Do you have some guidelines to this end? Do you see that there's tool support? Would you say there's one approach, or could be that there are several approaches? I would like to start a quick discussion with you how you see it. Do we address here a challenge which is really a challenge in practice? Or is it just something, let's say, what we see, since maybe our customers are not that experienced? Maybe this also could be the case. So it would be great if you could come back here also on Miro. And let's say, how do you see that along these questions? Is this a problem in practice here, or would you say, no, everything is clear? And if there are some problems, what from your perspective are problems? Is the tool support sufficient? Is the methodological guidance on how to do it best, sufficient? Or if there is not a general answer, are there some guidelines where you could say, okay, in my projects, I asked the following three questions, and then based on these, the answers to it, I decide, okay, we follow more one approach or the other. Kazuma, have you had the chance to also join in the Miro board, or are there some doubts on how to do it?
I think I am in the page now.
Ah, okay, very good, very good. It's a good point. I think Juha made it. So unfortunately, we cannot distinguish here the users, since in this version, there's no need that you log in of the Miro board. So everything is anonymous, but I would assume that Juha said that, and it's really true. Also, a lot of companies, they complain that the tools are not able to do this and that. And on the other hand side, if you have a look at the organizational maturity, what they can do with the experts, then the bigger problem is sometimes also there. And of course, a fool with a tool, it's clear how it ends. Therefore, the point, getting some guidance on how to do this best, that of course would be great. Yeah, here regarding this approach here of the domain-specific languages, I also agree there that this is a good approach, especially to capture also the domain knowledge. If you have a domain where you have a reasonable number of variants, often if I go to a company and then ask them, okay, how many variants do you see in the next 3 to 4 years, maybe where you can exploit reuse potential, and they say, it's 3 to 4, and then of course, let's say the challenge arises if there's or would make sense to have larger investments there. On the other hand side, if you talk about if you talk with companies where they have, let's say, several hundreds of product variants, maybe even a year, then of course this would make really lots of sense. Regarding the East ADL here, I think it's a good hint. To be honest, we tried it. Let's say we went there, and we have currently some ongoing master thesis. I think the support in MetaCase was quite good there, but we tried to get also some respective material for Enterprise Architect, or I think, I'm not sure if it was Papyrus or the other open sourcing, and that was there was not too much helpful material there. But that is definitely something you are what we maybe also after this tutorial here could come back to see what is your experience here in the topic in more detail. Good. While you are let's say typing it, so we have already the tool. We have here the let's say good. There's even more information regarding the DSL thing. The perspective that model-based approaches have to become more relevant. I would say companies sometimes they want to give it more relevance, but they do not have the necessary capabilities in the organization, and also not the necessary time. CBL, that's also, let's say, a good point. That this is often the thing, as I showed before, there's this triangle. You have language, tool, and method. And if you have some maturity problem in one of these things, you will have a problem with the whole approach. And therefore, also the maturity level in these different levels maybe should increase somehow. Good. While you are adding more information, I would propose I come back on it. I continue with the slides in here. Another thing in here regarding the challenges. I think some sound example models where we can see how things work or don't work, from my side, they are missing. We search for it, but if you already have found it, something which is publicly available, larger scale, UML, SysML model, which shows a bit the problems, that would be also quite cool to share some experience in here. Yeah, and as said, at least in the cases we were involved, if you ask people, do you have some guidelines on that? It's often, there are not really guidelines there. Good. The bio break we skip, since we have a longer break there. And if there are no questions from your side, I would like to dive deeper into the different variant management approaches in UML and SysML models. and that we get an overview what's there. And then later on, we can also see which maybe can be used and what are the experiences. So in the following, we would follow this overview on these different variant management approaches along these lines. First, we ask from the outside, what are the drivers or what are the variabilities which, let's say, typically show up? And then a company would have to ask, okay, which views in my system model, let's say we have a system architecture, which views are affected by that variant drivers? And then with that, they already know, okay, where in the model we will have certain changes since they are driven by respective drivers. And then they can think a bit about, okay, then how to realize this. And this is also how we want to approach it. So from the outside, what we often see in systems is that there are drivers which originate from the context, so to say. So the operational environment is somehow different. So the system maybe could be used, if we maybe talk about a railway system, the regulations will be different if you provide or run a train in France or in Germany. And therefore, also the size of the tracks is maybe different. And with that, if you sell a product into different regions, then the operational environment could be different. Peer systems could vary. So from the outside, maybe other systems are connected. Maybe in the train example, there may be different external systems, maybe in Germany or in France, which someone need to communicate with the train. The interfaces of two customer systems might change. Yeah, maybe they have a management system and the different customers, they use different protocols. Or the system context is simply different. Yeah, so there are more or less interfaces there. Why did I show up this in the beginning? These things are hard to control for you. You have to live with it. It depends a bit on which markets you want to sell something. And then you have, let's say, if these variabilities are there, they will have a considerable impact on your system architecture. Typically, structure-wise, more in the outside, but this we will see later on already could raise some questions on how to do this best. Then inside of a system, maybe there could be, you have a type or part library, which is updated, so new changes came in. You have a new release of a platform and must understand this, what was available in the previous release, what is now available, or properties of a system element, subsystem, or module is somehow changed over time. As we had already before in the ZF case, the input might arrive in the system via different paths. This means that maybe functionality is also deployed on different logical elements or different physical elements. And this allocation, if you have respective views, could cause some considerable difference. And then it's the question how to handle this. Data types which are processed could differ. Yeah, and then there are many more things which are inside of the system, which maybe at the outside do not show up, but where you have to handle the necessary changes inside of the system itself. For instance, event chains in the system are different, or the state machine has additional operational states, stuff like that. There are, of course, way more. The key message in here is understand what is the nature of the variant driver or the variability. Is it outside of your control or inside? And what is the change rate at a certain point of time and also over time? And typically you would elicit this information as part of a scoping. Yeah, where you see what are the variant drivers or the variabilities you define to which extent you will support necessary changes. And this then already is a fairly good input for the architect to think a bit about what changes will be required and how to maybe implement this best. There are some guidelines and also some, let's say, checklists on different types of variant drivers. I'm not that sure if you already have something or what you are using to this end, if there is something standardized, but of course, this is already a great help, let's say, to understand what is the nature of the driver. And where I see some kind of challenge are variabilities where over time new variants come in. So I would call this a variability with an open range. New alternatives are joining in over time. And typically, if you have such a kind of thing, you definitely should think a bit about how you can keep the impact of this open variability on your architecture as low as possible. So these variability drivers was the first step, understanding what is there, characterizing it. And then the second step would be to understand what views in the UML, SysML models are you using. So there are different types of diagrams. Typically, in SysML, I think that's quite a good overview. There are on the one hand side behavioral diagrams, which focus more on what the system is, let's say, doing in terms of state machines, activity diagrams, use cases, interaction diagrams. So they define the behavior. And on the other hand side, we somehow organize the system into, let's say, subsystems. So we modularize things. And with that, we maybe have a logical or physical decomposition or a functional decomposition, which shows a bit, okay, what are the building blocks we are talking about. And there are different views. Of course, we have typically in, for instance, in SysML models, if you want to be ASPICE compliant, we at least have a definition of the decomposition. So how is, let's say, the logical architecture decomposed? There could be also a functional decomposition or physical ones where we identify also respective interfaces. This is quite standardized, and you see this in, let's say, most of the system architectures, what we saw. And then it's about also the behavior. Activities, state charts, and so on. There we have considerable differences between the different approaches, but typically they also use at least one type of diagram, maybe sometimes more. And why I'm talking a bit about that is if you have a variant driver which has an influence on the structure, for instance, an interface is present or not, or a building block is present or not, this is something what you, it has an impact, but it's typically has still some quite local impact. If you change something in the behavior, that often causes variation points in lots of diagrams. So they are more cross-cutting. And with that, also one recommendation, of course, could be identify what is the nature of the variant driver. Is it more affecting the structure? Or is it maybe affecting the behavior of things? And to get also a better understanding or already some early understanding where in your architecture models the variant driver could have a respective impact. As a kind of first orientation, we provide here an overview on different types of different types of diagram in the horizontal axis, and in the vertical axis we have different variant drivers, what we clustered into: is it a variant driver in the context, in the effect chain, information flow, behavior, and so on. And we started with the first assessment. How is typically the impact? Do you have a low impact of these variant drivers in the respective diagrams, or do you have a high impact? Meaning, if you from scoping have some kind of idea what the variant drivers are and you can characterize it, and you know on the other hand side regarding your modeling methodology on how to do it and what diagrams you use, that here could give you a first indication where variation points maybe typically come up and where you can think a bit about on how to do it best. That's a first starting point, a draft, so to say, from our side. Would be great also if you would say, oh, regarding my experience, it's totally different here, it must be a full circle. So fully agree on that. So that really would be also good if you could put on the respective slide in the training material, maybe some comments where you would say, I have a different opinion in here. Good, so that's the impact on the variant driver on respective diagrams. And then, some time ago, we created a kind of simple landscape of different variability management approaches where we gave that also some icons in terms of, let's say, to have a visual recap. And these overall, from our experience, characterizes in a sufficient good manner what kind of different approach the company overall regarding their product variance and variability, what they are following. I don't want to explain everything right now. I will come back to one or the other approach while I'm talking. Of course, clone and own is quite clear. The product line engineering, where we, if we superimpose the different product variants, see what is inside of the common platform or reuse infrastructure, which then contains, let's say, the common parts, but also the variable parts. That's one typical approach. And what is postulated and also sold along the variability management tools, Big Lever Gears, Pure Variance. Let's see where meta case there is. I'm not that sure. Is this, let's say, production line approach? I have a feature model, and via the feature model, I completely can automate the derivation from, let's say, a 150% architecture model. In practice, we often see that the reality is somewhere in between in here, between these different things. So here are some transitions, what we saw in industry, and what we can conclude from that is there is no one size fits all approach. Typically, organizations, they have to diversify the approach in the product structure, that they maybe for the more stable parts, maybe they go for a platform or for the parts which have a high degree of variability, what they demand on the market, they maybe go for a production line.
May I quickly comment?
Yeah, of course.
I think the approach heavily depends on the type of variability they have.
That's true.
I know that in certain automotive systems, you can have this 150% model, mm-hmm. and have a feature model then picks the relevant features. Of course, the links between those features can become challenged, mm-hmm. but that's one approach. But then in other approaches, if I show one extreme, that I know that when Nokia was making the mobile phones, and they released 50 models a year, it would be impossible to build mobile phones with 150 models, meaning that the developer should know all family members at once. Mm. So rather than they only model the variant part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And the DSL part, what I also see is if you have a system which has a common system architecture where you maybe just have to remove parts, then you can follow the 150% approach or maybe also the product line. But if you have a system of system where maybe the overall composition of the system in terms of I have maybe from certain subsystems a varying number of instances and the wiring between the things is totally different, then I would say a pure feature-driven approach is also not sufficient, then more a DSL-based approach would be better. Yeah, so as you have said, it depends on the variability, what's in there, maybe also on the level where the variability comes up. But there we will also come back later on. Yeah, thank you very much for your comment here. Cloning, I think there's no need to explain this approach, but it's quite often used in practice. And we see it also as a, of course, intuitive way to handle variants in, for instance, system architectures or software architectures. Yeah, they build maybe the mid-range product. They have an architecture for that. And then they create a high-end product by adding additional stuff, or from there, from the mid-range product, create a copy and remove respective parts to end up more with the lower-end segments. Now, of course, this has some pros and cons, but it's fast and not too much necessary to bug with the necessary details or the differences. But the point is, of course, over time, once you have more and more model variants at hand, the question is a bit, if you have to start a new project, which is the one which fits you the best, which is the best starting point. And if you have features which you maybe developed in model variant 2, and you want to provide it also into the newer version of model variant 1, then it's the question on how to do that. As said, we are working a lot with Enterprise Architect, and there this, how shall I say, the comparison, the diff and the merge of different model variants is not that well supported. Let's say it's getting better, but there were some challenges. That was also the reason why we investigated what can be done with a tool from Liba called LemTree, which allowed a kind of model configuration management thing. So they were able to do a diff and a patch based on Enterprise Architect models, for instance. But we see in here, this there is obviously some open need, where then maybe an additional company tries to fulfill this. At our side, we had this setting where we have a large scale Enterprise Architect model, which we had to evolve together and then combine things to the main branch. What we did was we developed a small own tool called Delta AR. And let's say what I like was, it was not just that we were able to compare version 1, for instance, with version 2 or variant 1 with variant 2, but we were able to create a kind of delta model, which just contained the differences between, two different versions. And I found this quite helpful, since in that you just see where did we change something in the model, and you see the change crystal clear. Of course, this delta model would not make sense to build something, since it just contains the differences. But for understanding what has changed from version 1 to version 2, that was quite helpful. And I thought that this may be also a good or something which in your daily work maybe could also be helpful if you work with clones. And of course, there's then also some kind of patch where you have to think a bit about. So if there are changes between two different models, how can you identify the change and how can you patch the change maybe on the main line, for instance. But that somehow should be clear. With this slide here, I want to shape the landscape of different, let's say, system architectures and modules, and how the organization tackles it with the respective modularization approach. More from the perspective of maybe some hardware-oriented disciplines. So what we found there was this overview on different modularization approaches, how maybe a car or how a physical product often is structured. And it's a good thing, it's quite similar to some things we can do also in software, but in software we sometimes can do more, since in software we can change the system easily while it is already out there in the field. Let's say with hardware, that's not that easy. And of course, there's the platform approach, let's say, where you just have the common platform, and then the application projects, they build the add the missing parts, or where as part of the platform, you have the core, but maybe some variable building blocks, optional modules, so to say, what you can add to the platform. So that's the typical approach, what you also would see as part of a product line. And then sometimes we see this, that they build or provide a modular building kit with a fixed architecture, then you just have the modules, and it's like Lego. You have the Lego bricks, they have their interfaces, you can combine them, but what you are going to build based on the this building kit could be totally different applications. So we see this especially, let's say, on the supplier level. You have maybe some supplier who produces some car modules, and maybe inside of these modules, they have some recurring topics. So with that, they build internally maybe a building kit where different higher level product line architectures or product line platforms can use the respective building blocks. And finally, there's the free modularization where we have, let's say, the building blocks with some interfaces, but you can combine them in an arbitrary way. So there is no common architecture, so to say. And why I'm explaining this in here, if you are here in the beginning where you have a common architecture of thing, then of course, let's say variability in the system or software level architecture, this may be something what you can address with a 150% approach, where you have features, and via features you activate or deactivate some building blocks. The more you go to the right side, you have more just the modules, and the knowledge on the architecture level, how to combine these modules, you cannot express this in a closed manner. So there you would have to find different ways how to guide the architects, maybe by just give them some kind of guidance on how to put this together, or maybe by using some DSL based approach where you have the necessary language to describe the overall system composition on the level of the system architecture. Let's say you provide the language, and then depending on the customer needs, things are put together. Good. Now let's dive a bit into these different variability realization approaches. The first thing could be composition. So we have on the platform some modules which could be combined. They have identified interfaces, and it's like Lego. I have the building blocks, but what I can build with the Lego could be totally different. I can build a car, but I could also build a helicopter. And what I maybe could provide is that I give some kind of guidance how things could be composed, but that's it. If you have a look on variability management approaches or mechanisms, Then the reuse of libraries, the usage of predefined building blocks could be followed. And this of course also could be done as part of models. Yeah, if I'm having a SysML model or a UML model, what I could do is I maybe have my system level architecture and I'm reusing some libraries. For instance, a library which contains the definition of standard units. Or the library which defines the key features we have in the organization or the key functionalities, or a library which maybe contains a state machine. Yeah? So that could be something I can offer in the repository, some package with recurring or content which could be reused in the different system variants. And what I have as a mechanism to support the necessary change is just importing libraries and maybe also extending or modifying libraries. The UML tools or the support this to this end so that you can import packages into the system itself. Some of them have also more sophisticated module management so that you could also have different versions, for instance, of a module, or once there is a change in a module, you could also import it. If you want to follow this approach, you should ask yourself, for instance, if you import a library into your model, what happens with the element IDs during the import? Will they kept the same, or will they become new ones? What happens if you re-import a model part? So if there's a new version of the library, can you re-import it? And then what's happening there? Then also some kind of question, does the tool support a diff? So can you compare, for instance, you imported this library once and there's a new version of the library in the repository. Can you compare this easily to understand if it makes sense to re-import the stuff? Or how can you do a diff with an external model part? So the key thing in here would be model management in terms of modules, what you can do. So can you work with packages? And then it would be great to have a diff patch or a linking approach, which you could apply on the respective models. For the enterprise architect, there are some capabilities there, but they are quite limited. Other tools like Rhapsody are better in doing this. I'm not that sure how Cameo is doing to this end, but I have heard also that should be a bit better than the enterprise architect. But this is definitively a good approach if you maybe have not this high amount of features, which are well, high amount of product variants, and you want to take the first steps into the reuse of some model parts, maybe try to package things into libraries and then think a bit about how to reuse them. A key challenge often also in there is, of course, if I have a library and with that I have somehow modularized my system architecture, and the library could be organized in a way that it's just a single package which is affected by a certain feature, then life is easy. Yeah, you could maybe replace a single package and you're done. But you see also some companies who want to work along features. And then these features are often some cross-cutting things, so they affect changes in several libraries. And then it's also the question on how this could be organized. We had a recent thesis also in the field of requirements where we also had this more feature-based modularization. And in principle, we guess this can also be applied for UMLs and SysML models, but that is definitely a challenge. Yeah, so ask yourself sometimes if there is a new version of it, is this possible or do you have one shot to use the library? And if it is there and there's a change in the respective libraries, you have to apply or do them manually. That's definitely something where I would say if you have your approach and you know your tool, try to investigate what the tool capabilities are there. Again, with the Enterprise Architect, I know that along with the Lemon Tree, there is now also a module management system where they organize the software into, or the model itself into packages, which can be considered as independent modules. And then there is the source model, and from there you can provide modules into a repository to build up the reuse infrastructure, and from there take respective packages integrated into your new variant model, so to say, and then track changes between the different worlds. But this is a work in progress for the EA. As said, in Rhapsody and most probably also in Cameo, this topic is better supported already. Good. So first thing was composition. So we have the building blocks. We have the, let's say, libraries, so to say. But there is not much guidance on which libraries to choose and how to integrate the libraries automatically in the respective variant model where you're currently working on. The next kind of approach are the selection approaches. So I have a superset architecture model, which contains, which maybe could be the quite close to the architecture of the high-end system. So it contains all the features. And from there, you start to strip away or remove or subtract features which are not required. And there we then typically talk about feature catalogs or feature models. The feature is deactivated. And inside of the model, you have the knowledge on where a feature is implemented and where it shows up. And with that, via some automation, you could remove respective parts. A first approach to this end, which could be used there, is what we could call module replacement. So compared to the thing we saw before, where we had one library, there we maybe have two different variants of a library. And depending on what feature set is selected, either the variant A of the library is included or variant B of the library is included. So that's this module replacement approach, yeah, which we could see it could be followed if you have this more product line approach, yeah, where some variability is or some variable features are supported by the reuse infrastructure, but not everything. So if your tool supports, let's say, the reuse of libraries or the import of libraries, then what you of course could do in here is that you provide the core, a kind of core part of the model, which includes a placeholder for a certain library. And then you have different library variants in your repository. And depending on what is the feature set you have selected, you maybe take library A and integrate this into your system model. So that's still a kind of compositional approach, but here the composition would be predefined. You know what libraries should be included, you know the variants of the libraries, And then once it is decided, the model is composed. Again, it would be good to know what happens with the element IDs while you're doing that. What happens if you re-import a model part? If you have support for diff, and can you also support external parts of the models? So this year we see in industrial practice is often not that much considered, but we said it's good to keep an eye on this, since this would allow a reuse in the large. I have larger blocks what I could reuse. And sometimes I simply replace, let's say for the respective models, modules, I maybe choose the module which just contains the functionality for the low end or low segment products. And I maybe have a respective library for the high end products, since they are working in a different way. So that's this module replacement. In general, that could work. Here, some kind of example. We have a model with a generic element that's like a placeholder. And depending on what feature is selected from the model library, we choose that library which should be integrated into the specialized model for our variant. And then we have some mechanism. This is either done automatically or manually. Of course, automatically would be the better choice. Now, the next stage would be that we have these annotation as we know it from the so-called 150% approaches, which follows a kind of preprocessor idea. So all the possible changes or the influence of features is modeled. And if we don't have the feature, we simply remove it from the model. So the idea here is that the variation points in the models, they are annotated maybe with a logical expression based on features in a feature model. And then if certain features are not selected, then a preprocessor can run over it. So here in this example, we have some elements, some interfaces, which are not there all the time. First of all, I could highlight them. I should gray them out and say, okay, these are not there all the time. They are not common. They could vary between the different model variants. And here's another example. And then if I connect it with a higher level feature model, that I know which variation points. So let's call those elements which are not in the model there all the time. Let's call them variation points. We could express a respective feature logic. So here this depends on the acceleration to speed feature. And if the feature is selected, it remains in the model variant for that specific instance. And if it is not selected, it's automatically removed. So this is the thing what we get from the variability management tools, typically from a pure variance, Big Lever Gears. We see also that some PLM-like-ish systems also adapt this variability modeling approach. And with that, the feature models could also be stored there. But it's often then the question on how these variation points, how can we connect this to the features what we somewhere have in some external model. So it's like, for those who know C programming, there is this C preprocessor. It brings a dedicated language based on which you can express some elements which are not there all the time. And it can formulate respective decisions, constraints. And this is what we see with these variability modeling tools. They add some annotations into the respective elements in there. They connect it with a feature model. With that, then they can highlight some variability. So where are variation points? What is affected? if a certain feature is in there, or how does the mid-range system differ from the low-end system, for instance. What's quite good in here is to understand what are the supported granularities. For instance, if we talk about the enterprise architect, I cannot support a variation point for every, let's say, item in the model. I can maybe remove blocks, but removing a parameter from a method is maybe not supported, since in that modeling tool, this is simply not possible or not supported. So really one question in here, and that's something to consider from the very beginning. Where do you have variation points? And does the modeling tool or the variability management tool support variation points in this respective granularity? And here the combination, for instance, pure variance and EA is not the best. That's more a matter of the enterprise architect. Yeah? I learned that Cameo offers the most possibilities for variation points. But for instance, for the enterprise architect, you are quite limited on where you can express or implement variation points by following this approach. There are some more things I would like to share on this, but I would propose that we have the break as scheduled. So the idea was that we come back at 3 p.m. And what we then will do is there is one mechanism left. Then I have, or we have created a first pattern catalog of different variability realizations. And then we will dive deeper into how variability is maybe affected by changes over times and the respective guidelines. So if there are no urgent questions, then I would propose that we all take a bio break, get some fresh coffee, and then continue the things here at 3 p.m. in Central European time, or at 2 in the British time. Are there some questions? Nope. Then I hope to see you in 25 minutes. Andreas, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Good. So far for the presentation, and was everything reasonable, or am I too slow, too fast?
I think we need to hurry up a little bit. Mm-hmm. So if I see correctly, we have not yet reached the half of our slides, or it depends on the examples you want to show, or how many examples you want to show.
Yeah, the I want to go a bit quicker over them, since the participants will be able to come back on them later on. Ah, we have a new participant, by the way.
Yes, I think we have at least two.
Okay, so Mrs. Lee, are you in the call here? Can you hear me? Oh, there's this background noise. Incoming calls, sorry. Hello, Mrs. Lee, can you hear me? Maybe.
Oh, yes, I can hear you.
It's great to have you here. I have to say we are currently having a short break.
I see.
But let's say as you joined in a bit late, we could use the time that I explain you a bit where we are now, and get you also a bit accustomed with the material, how we share it, and how we organize the tutorial in here, if you don't mind.
No, I see, I can.
Okay, good. First of all, there is, besides the slides, what we show, also some interactive system called Miro or Miro. And it would be good if you could dial in there. So here it is. So we have put this hyperlink here also in the chat. And if you click on it, you will be connected to a website. If you use the password VM at MBSE exclamation mark, that's the password to enter in there. And then I could explain you a bit how this system works.
Martin?
Yes?
I think Ms. Lee is joined us 1 hour ago.
So okay.
She also already joined the Miro board, I think. Am I correct, Ms. Lee?
Yes, yes, I joined, but I didn't leave any message to the board.
Okay.
So I will find how to use this board during the break time.
Are you connected to it? And I could explain it to you briefly.
Oh, yes, I am connected.
Can you go to this interactive page here, first one?
I can't find how to access the interactive board. I can see just the one board. Oh, I see.
I can bring you to me.
Oh yeah. I'm here in the interactive board. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Which one are you? Okay.
Maybe
if you click double click on one of the cards.
Oh yeah, Guest Explorer. Yes, here.
Okay, you start.
Yeah, I'm here.
Now if you start typing, then you see you can fill in the card.
Can you see my message?
I can see it, yes. JBNU is a university or is
this Jambung National University.
Okay. Great to have you here. You are more from university, right? So if you don't mind, I would move you a bit here into the you can grab your note. Can you click on it? And then track it maybe to the left side. I can do it for you. So I would assume since we sat here on the left-hand side, we put maybe those people who work in research and on the right-hand side on industry. What is your experience regarding modeling? Is it beginning or expert?
Oh, I'm not an expert. I am a beginner.
A reasonably good understanding.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. If there's also a context menu, so if you click on it, bring to front and you can see the respective card. Okay. What are your expectations? So if we go to the next thing in here, what are there some expectations regarding the training?
I have to write down here.
This is
my expectation here.
Here on the this board to the left.
I was wrong. I'm here.
The title of the board you see on top of it.
Yes, I'm done.
Okay, very good. So, yeah, okay. Yep, very good. That's exactly what we are talking about here.
Oh, yeah.
So that's should fit quite well. Good. I just saw here that you arrived a bit later. Ah, there are more participants. Like Alessandro, which I didn't see before. Okay, but it's maybe not that big problem. Good. I would propose we take a short break and then continue at. Let's say 2 p.m. or 3 p.m., depending on the time zone in which you are currently thinking.
Thank you.
So in 15 minutes. Good. So, Andrea, so meaning I will speed up, indicate some of the patterns. Maybe take 20 minutes and then the ball is at your side. Andreas, are you still there?
Yes, I'm still there. So, okay, you need 20 more minutes and you're leaving on?
I would leave
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. Yeah, my idea was, as mentioned, that we maybe have now a 1 hour slot. Starting at 3,
mm-hmm.
and then we again take a break of half an hour. I have my meeting in between, and then I can also participate in the last half hour.
Yes, that sounds good.
Otherwise, you simply wrap it up, and that's it. But as there are some here, some interactive parts, maybe 20 minutes. Let's consider it. It will take half an hour.
It's also okay. I think I have around 25 slides,
mm-hmm.
and I think I also need half an hour, 40 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we reduce the break to 20 minutes from 3:10 mm-hmm. to half past 3:30.
Okay, good. Overall, for the slides, what we have, I think it should be good enough to convey the central messages. Sometimes it maybe would be good to have the central message also on the slides. Let's say if there's one sentence they should keep in mind for the slide.
Mm-hmm.
But let's say this we can, let's say, see later on. Good, then let's take a short bio break. I think overall, that should work quite well. You also sent me some notes. Okay. The challenge with that is that most probably the notes are gone once we close the meeting. Therefore, we should do a wrap up once we finish the training in here. Before.
Yes, I already saved the comments from Juha
mm-hmm.
On the mirror board.
Mm-hmm.
Like we planned on the slide capture down on the mirror board with the sticky notes.
Okay. Very good. Good. Then see you at 3. I take a short bio break.
Yes. See you at 3.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
So good. I would assume that all of you are back on your seats, at least the ones who would like to join. So before the break, the last mechanism what we had was annotation. In the code level, we could call this also conditional compilation, meaning that there are some parts maybe in our model which are will not remain in the final variant of this respective model which we are currently developing, but some parts will be removed. And for this, there is on the one hand side tool support, like the variability management tools, BigLever Gears, Pure Variants. But to some extent, you could follow the same approach also maybe with homebrew tools, so that you, I've seen also that companies who developed or followed the same approach, but with their own kind of tooling. So they had some simple macros or whatsoever, which ran over the system architecture or the architecture model and removed stuff which were not necessarily needed. Good, that is one approach. We will hear a bit more on this approach in the following slides, but before we continue, I would like to mention that also in models, we could follow the approach that the variability remains in the model. And via parameters, for instance, we control a bit how the model behaves. So the idea there is not that we remove some parts from the model, which we do not require, but we keep it in, but we use somehow parameters to control how the model is behaving. In UML, SysML, parameters could be maybe used on the one hand side as part of methods, where we have the respective parameters, we can give them a default value, that's one thing, or also as part of attributes, if we have the, let's say, if we change the default value. Another way of using parameterization is, for instance, if you use at least UML supports, is also that we could have some parameterized templates. So we could have a class which has some template parameters, and then depending on what actual value is provided for the parameter inside, once you instantiate a respective model element, then the parameter value is replaced by the current value what you proposed. So also templates are one way where you could use that. And another way how parameters could be used is inside of tagged values. So the tagged values is the extension mechanism, let's say, of UML, and that also available in SysML, where you can provide additional information for a class or a block in terms of some key value pairs. And also, you could also use, for instance, tagged values, which you can introduce for your respective project needs. And there you can provide the respective parameters, so to say, and can provide respective values, what you evaluate from the model itself. So this parameterization, that's often forgotten, but that's a standard mechanism that could be used also in models with the idea, for instance, in a state machine, you could model all the possible state transitions, and you control the possibility that a certain transition could happen, for instance, via some configuration parameter. And if a feature is deactivated, then maybe certain transitions cannot happen. Yeah. So this is for those who have some programming language experience, a different approach. Yeah, we could have this conditional compilation there before the model or the code is evaluated by the compiler. You remove the stuff. That's one way of doing it. And the other thing would be conditional execution. So you have some maybe transitions or some flows in your architecture. All of them are there, but you can control the possible transitions by respective guards. And this will also dive a bit deeper in here. Here there's an example. I could have maybe a state machine. And yeah, of course, the models, they are evaluated both by humans and by machines. And for instance, if I have transitions where I place an additional guard in front, then I could activate or deactivate this transition. In that sense, if I deactivate a feature and this is part of a guard in a transition, this transition never could happen. And with that, I could work with a kind of superset state machine, and via parameterization, I control how the possible transitions could happen. It's as with, let's say, code, similar idea. In the code, then maybe I have more functions or more, let's say, as part of if conditions, some blocks which are maybe by configuration ruled out that they never could happen, but they remain in the program. Good to know in here, if you consider that, is to think a bit about what is, for instance, supported by SysML, UML to this end. So for instance, in state machines, you can do this quite well. Also in sequence diagrams, you could make use of that. And of course, also good to know what is the number of variants what you are facing, since if you have a high number of variants there, this could mean that you have a very large state machine, which is hard to understand. And with that, it's better to support somehow really also the customization or the tailoring of the state machine to the respective system variant. As we already have heard, what's the right mechanism here depends heavily on the nature of the variability or of the variant driver. Is it just a minor number of different alternatives, or is it just an option, or is it something which changes again and again? And if you have this, then you maybe have to follow a different approach. Okay. With this, I want to close this first introduction of these different variability management approaches. So we had this landscape where we said, okay, many companies, they are targeting to go from clone and own to something more platform-based, like a product line where the key functionality, even if it is variable, is supported already from the platform. Some go to the production line, but as we already heard from the comments, in many projects, let's say putting everything first in the common core and then stripping away is not a way to go. There, as in the product line here, the approach that the thing with or the features with the reuse potential, they are supported by the platform, so to say, and the application specific features are left to the application projects. Library reuse was one of the first approaches where we saw, okay, this can be used if you have a product line. Here for the variable parts, you maybe could provide libraries which are included or not, or module replacement. If you have different variants of a module, you can replace it. Then this annotation or this conditional compilation supported by the tools is typically something what we see around this 150% approaches. There we also make use of parameterization, either a parameterization via features or via some more fine-grained parameters. And conditional execution is typically something what we would see if you have an approach where the model still contains the all possible behaviors, and we keep it in the model, and just via parameterization, we can activate or deactivate certain behavior. What I was missing in here is what we already had also in the discussion is the DSL approach, where we had a dedicated language for the, let's say, to open the variability space. And then during the specification of the product variant, you formulate in that language how your system looks like. In the discussion, we had this with these modular building blocks, where we would say, okay, we have the modules, but how to compose them and how to instantiate them, you maybe have to have a higher level language to this end. Good. Here, for me, the point was maybe some activity, what we could do in Miro quickly. There is a board. Here, where we ask you regarding the variability mechanisms. So in our landscape here, I have introduced some which we reason, which we typically see, but there could be more. There could be also more what you maybe already used. And that would be, of course, great. Let's say that you add them in here to show if there is something missing. Yeah, the DSL are already mentioned, but maybe there are more things regarding the mechanisms where you would say, okay, this or that, I see in addition what you have not covered so far. If so, please add them. If you see further mechanisms and then if you have additional ones, it also would be good if you could explain a bit when you use them and why. You know how to do this, right? Then meanwhile, I already could continue with the presentation. And for instance, I would like to add also DSLs here. You are, if you maybe could also add what are the specific conditions where the DSLs have a strong advantage over the other approaches, more the compositional or the selection approaches, that would be good. And if the others have additional comments, please add them. Good. Before the break, I mentioned that we, once we have the first understanding what the different mechanisms are, want to introduce you some work we have started, namely to create a kind of pattern catalog, which show a bit how variability mechanisms could be used. And this is what I'm going to show you in, let's say, the next minutes. So the idea was to have in a model, some typical patterns which could happen as part of daily modeling activities, and then show how to realize this. We realized these things here, or the patterns, what we see at the right-hand side, we already have realized in the combination Enterprise Architect together with Pure Variance. I will not explain all of these things, but maybe some things, especially where we see also the shortcoming of this, this pure feature driven approach. And this is also something what we maybe could discuss either here in, the, in this tutorial or also after the tutorial. I would be interested that we maybe create kind of this pattern catalog, show it also how it would look like maybe in other tools. And if we then have industrial practitioners, we could tell them, okay, these are the typical situations which come up. You have some first guidance on how this could be done. And then once they see how we follow different methodology, one maybe could translate it and say, okay, in our tool, we do it somehow in a different manner. This is work in progress. We are currently working on it. If you want to join us in doing this, feel free to do so. This pattern catalog, we structured it into some variability related patterns which come up along structure and others along behavior. As mentioned, since they have different variant drivers and most probably they have also a different impact. Before diving into the detail, I would like to explain you how variation points can be realized in Enterprise Architect by using pure variance. And let's say, as mentioned before, you could follow the same approach even if you don't use pure variance. It's a kind of annotation-based approach where you identify those elements which are variant, which are not there all the time, and you provide maybe somehow knowledge in which situation to remove the things and which to keep ones. That's the quite simple. So the idea how pure variance does it is it adds the logic or the conditions if a certain element in the model is included or not, either in dedicated constraint elements. This is shown in here. So the constraint looks like a UML comment. You can also use this in SysML. If you want to use it for variability management with pure variance, there must be the pure variance restriction. If you want to follow your own approach, you simply in the stereotype could maybe write, okay, this is for variability management or this is for variant handling. And then there could be different approaches. Yeah, if you here in this case, we have an overarching feature model which defines the feature warnings. And this here states if the product variant, what we are currently investigating does not include the feature warnings, then this transition here remains. So it should be in the model. If warnings is selected, then this expression here would be evaluated to false. And in this case, you would have to remove this transition or this connector from the respective state machine. So that's one way of realizing variation points. Yeah, you could in respective comments in the UML SysML language place respective conditions or explanations if a certain variant element should be there or not. And then either the human or the machine can run over the model, check if the warnings feature is there or not, and remove or keep the respective elements. So that's one way. We have the feature logic in here, and we have can embed it in special type constraints. So the distinction here, if this is a variation point, is done via this stereotype in here. The other way of embedding it, what pure variance supports, is inside. You could also have constraints inside of model elements, like here the state. And then you, this is represented in these curly braces. And you could also include the feature logic. Let's say, yeah, if this means here warnings is here. Inside embedded into the model elements. The point in here is you cannot do this for all language elements. Yeah, there are, for instance, the warnings or the constraints cannot be embedded, I guess, also in connectors. And there are also some other elements where you can't place it. Let's say to conclude on this in here, this is an annotation-based approach, which is independent of a tool. You can follow the same approach if you don't have a tool. And with that, advise your modeling experts, hey, here are elements which are variable or variant, and you can tell them when to include and when to remove something. And the key idea, which is supported here by peer variance, is that you formulate presence conditions over the feature configuration. So you have a set of features, what you have selected, and the presence condition checks if the condition is true. If it is true, the element remains here. So if warning is not in the system model, this here would be included, and otherwise this state here would be chosen. That's the key idea, but that's language or tool independent. What I did not show in here is another approach, what we did in the past called decision modeling. And I think it's still valid. I asked once Dave Weiss what he thinks, what's important for variability management in product lines. And he said, okay, you somehow have to share the knowledge with between the ones who develop the customizable module on the reuse infrastructure to the application engineers. And a simple way of doing it is simply writing it down as part of a decision model, which is a textual representation. So in one of our approaches, we used a stereotype variant. So we, for those elements which were not there all the time, we added a stereotype variant. With that, it was clear, for instance, let's assume update display here has the variant stereotype. This is could be variant. And then there was a textual explanation in a separate document, which explained you in which situation to keep and in which situation to remove the display. This is also quite straightforward and let's say really an approach which does not require much tool support, but can help you already to identify elements which are there or not. Good, so these are the basic mechanisms what we have. Big Lever Gears follows a different approach. There you can have for the variation points, some kind of scripts formulate. So you could also maybe change model elements. So not just let's say removing them, but somehow maybe change the name of values. And that's a bit different approach, but I don't want to dive deeper into this in the tutorial here. Good. Let's see what kind of patterns we have in there. Yeah, first, quite simple one would be we have, for instance, in our system a library which could be there or not. Let's assume package 3 is a library which is included or not. So if you would like to follow this annotation approach, we could connect it to a kind of constraint and say the presence here of this library package 3 depends on an optional feature somewhere. If the option is selected, the thing remains, otherwise it's removed. And then let's say if we have no additional tool support, the engineers can go through the model, find, okay, where do we have constraint elements, check the condition. If the condition is true, keep it, otherwise remove it. So that's quite straightforward. And a base mechanism, for instance, to have a conditional inclusion of a model library part, for instance. In the intro, we had also this module replacement where we could include different alternatives of packages. Here in the example, we did that this following way. We have two variation points. Since they are connected to variation constraint nodes, so to say, let's say according to the pure variance notation, here we are asking if the first alternative is selected, then package 1 remains, otherwise package 2 remains, package 3 remains. With the idea, yeah, we have described which packages to include and remove the package variants what we don't have. Already in this example, you already could mention, oh, stop. That's maybe not that trivial. Let's assume we have two packages where we define different units, or where we define a refined behavior, a kind of state machine. Obviously, in the overarching package or in the other model which is around, there will be some kind of references to model elements which are in package one and in package two and package three. Since the whole model would like to make use of the content of two and three, and then you have to think a bit about how you can somehow realize this, that you have, let's say, content in those alternative packages which could change. But on the other hand side, from the outside, you must know that a certain block type, for instance, is somehow defined. Therefore, we already could learn this does only work in predefined conditions where you have a very clear understanding what is the content of the different packages and what is the dependency from the outer parts of the model into these packages. But nevertheless, it's possible. And as we will see later on, it's also quite key that you have such kind of support in order to select, let's say, model content, which could be somehow on a larger scale, where we would say it's not just about individual classes or blocks which are modified, but the bigger interplay. As optional and alternative packages, we could have the same also for, of course, elements in SysML, for instance, blocks. There's not, let's say, if it is an internal optional element, there's not so much to care, same way of handling it, simply marking it as a variation point and providing the logic. Similar with the alternative elements, there the point is the alternative elements typically as part of your model show up like an option. And in the variability model, you know that these optional features here, alternative one and two, together are grouped under one variability, meaning that exactly one of these has to be present. Maybe one thing what we already could see, this knowledge is not represented here anymore in the model itself. You just see the options and you have to go back maybe to your overarching variability model to see if these are options here or if these are alternatives. Yeah, since typically you would not directly see it in the name of the thing. Since it could be quite important, for instance, to say here's the interface and I must have exactly one peer who's connected to it. And if you don't want to express it in addition again and again at the different parts of the model, then of course it would be good to extract that, put it into this overarching feature model, but then you also have to keep this an eye on. A bit more tricky it starts to become if you have an alternative element with specialized interfaces, meaning there could be an interface which could be there or not. There we have, let's say, different elements. They maybe have different specialization of a type of interface. And depending on what is chosen, you choose the respective alternative element. And then you have to assure that the interface at the peer whom you are talking to can support both alternatives. Yeah, and then it's already the question on, let's say, how to do it best or how to do that best. One way of handling that could be that you, inside of your model, describe the overarching or the general interface, which could be there. And then you have two specializations, the one for your alternative one, the one for alternative two. They specialize somehow this kind of interface, which can collaborate here with this element. And depending on what is chosen in the element in the system, one or the other interface remains. Another thing could be you have maybe alternative system elements with a runtime binding in the model, meaning all the variants maybe remain in the system you provide to the customer. And at runtime, it is via some switch configured if a certain element or a certain functionality is used or not. Here we realized it like that. We have a runtime configuration provider. That's an element which provides the current configuration at runtime. We have a switching element, and based on the configuration, the switching element activates either alternative one and alternative two. Here in this case, as we were using a variability management tool, we said, oh, we could model it in that way that in the overarching feature model, we have an OR feature, which we, let's say, keep once we build the final product. But if we want to understand the impact or the different behavior of the system at runtime, we also could, for instance, use the highlighting feature of the variability management tool to show us the impact, for instance, of a certain feature. And here we were controlling this with this OR feature one underscore one. So even if we maybe have variability which can be bound at runtime, and with that all the variability is part of the product, we still could use the variability management feature of a tool or of your home prune approach to analyze while you are modeling the impact of features, to highlight it and to say what would happen if the feature is not included, for instance. Maybe the last thing I would show along the more structural patterns is what we call optional boundary element. This would mean you have an element which is close to maybe the boundary of the system of interest, meaning if this element here is there or not, it has an influence also on the externally visible interfaces. In this case, we had something. If the element is there, then we offer to the outside this optional element interface. Yeah, it's a special kind of interface. If not, if it is not included, then we keep the standard service, which is offered all the time. And this could be then, for instance, realized with variation point indicating that the interface and the optional boundary element could be there or not. We have the negated presence condition and have it at the standard interface, meaning if the feature is there, we just see the green interface. If the feature is not there, then we keep the blue interface in there. And with that, we could activate or deactivate building blocks, which are also visible at the outside. I skip over the alternative boundary element and some other things. Last one maybe to mention in here is, let's say, the structural composition. Let's assume we have, let's say, defined blocks or classes, what we could use, and not all of them are used, and they could use in a different times. So they are instantiated several times, and then depending on how you compose your systems, they are differently composed. This is something what it's quite hard to model with this annotation approach, what I showed before. Since there you, if a feature is requires a varying number of instances and the composition, so the combination of the building blocks differs a lot, you cannot describe this in a 150% model. Their more suitable approach is maybe that you, in a comment, like in decision modeling, describe a bit what is what could vary, and then what are the necessary steps that should be taken by the human to add all the instances of the blocks you require, and then what is the reasoning how to combine these things. So that's an example where you could use a textual description with a, let's say, predefined, yeah, we also could have added here some respective stereotype. Here we have this variability realization guide as the string to identify the different nodes. And then the knowledge on how to instantiate or to compose, you put inside of the node. And with that, the architect gets some guidance, maybe what to consider and what to what he can forget about. So this is if you have more, let's say, a high range or high variety on the overall system architecture in terms of how many instances of building blocks are there and how they are interconnected. That's one way to go. The other way, of course, which could fit quite well in here would be domain-specific languages. For the behavior, I skipped let's say that obvious parts like optional alternative activities. This works as in principle as with the elements what we have seen. An interesting thing here with alternative activity could be if you change the allocation of something, or if the alternative is there or not. Typically in behavior, this would have a high influence also on the wiring, how things are interconnected. And that could make stuff definitively in the activity diagrams, if you have to handle alternatives, way more complicated. So be aware if you have alternative behavior to think a bit about if you want to do this based on annotation of one 150% model, or if you want to do it somehow in a different way. For the allocation, for instance, that happens quite often. You have a certain functionality. The functionality is there all the time. But it could either be allocated, let's say, maybe on one computer or the other. And what are the alternatives? What you can do there is two reasonable approaches. First one, you model both allocations in different diagrams and remove the not selected one. So you could do, let's say, two diagrams. Let's assume activity one or two here is could be either allocated on block two or block A. So you could have two diagrams, one showing that it is allocated on block B and one which shows that it is allocated on block A. The question which then arises is how to delete the respective diagram. And I can show you in a second how to do this. The other one would be that you simply have one diagram, the one which is used the most, and then you provide additional guidance to the architect in a respective node, what he should do if activity is not is allocated on block A and not on block B. We showed this in here. So first approach would be we have different alternative allocations. Yeah, we modeled the two diagrams. And the point, for instance, in Enterprise Architect, the diagram, or you cannot add a constraint to a diagram. And the diagram itself, you also cannot link a constraint element with diagrams. So there is no chance to say in the model tree, for instance, here, this diagram is variant. It's not there all the time. Okay, what can you do? You can put it into a package. And then you could say the variation point is on the package level. You remove the package, as I showed before, alternative packages. This then keeps either the composition or the allocation diagram one or the second one. And with that, you could implement this, that you provide architectures, let's say, in different flavors and different allocations, and you just choose the one which is required. Or the other approach, of course, could be you have just one diagram and then add as a textual description what needs to be modified if you have chosen a different variant. That's quite straightforward, let's say, to guide the human. Of course, you could also think a bit about to use some code or model transformation tool, so a bit more formal approach, but that was also beyond the scope of this tutorial. Some two last things I would like to draw your attention to in this part is, if we have these two ways of realizing variation points, so either placing the presence condition inside of elements or adding it via a constraint and with that the separate model element, what is best? One then should be one way or the other. For embedding this year, good thing is this uses less space. It's embedded inside of the element, so it does not increase the overall model complexity. If you have an external constraint like this in here, this means we have the advantage that we can reuse this. For instance, let's assume error state is also depending on the presence of not warnings that with the same presence condition. We simply could track a link from error state here to that thing. And with that, we have the same logic. So constraint elements could be reused. And another thing is the visibility of this information that this here is a variation point is not affected by the diagram settings. So if you're an enterprise architect, you could say hide the constraints, and with that, this section here would not be shown. And with that, you no longer would see that check values is a variation point. Therefore, here our recommendation would be maybe try to use just external constraints, something like this here, if possible. Only if you have to deviate from that, let's say, use the internal things. And if you use this external constraints, so the additional constraint elements, then the next question is where to locate this in your model. I will explain you what this means. If I have, for instance, the variable package in here, and I have a constraint node which says this here is a variation point. What I could do is I have for each variable element such a constraint node. So I have this in here, and let's assume also package two has the same constraint node. Then I would create additional one in here and link it with it. Also, it maybe has the same presence condition. This creates a lot of copies of constraints. On the other hand side, if you would have a change in the dependency, so that package 3 no longer depends on option 1, but now on option 2, on optional feature 2. The good thing is here, if you modify this, you have just the effect on that respective package and don't have an effect on others. If you then have a look in the model hierarchy, you see once you create, let's say, such a kind of diagram, the these constraint nodes will become visible. And it's now also, if in this diagram I have a second constraint, also this would be added in here. And therefore, the point also could be you place these constraint nodes not, let's say, close to the elements where they are used, but maybe create a new element in your structure, which introduces all the variability constraints, and with that the used logics, place them there, and from there you track it onto your model. So that is here the central variability package. So I have one package in here which just includes this variability constraints. From there, I track it on my respective diagrams and link it there. Positive with this is the constraints are very easy to find and you just have them once. As you have them once, it's also quite easy to identify the elements which have the same constraint, which have the same presence condition. Yeah, it simply can be queried in the tool. Let's say what's a bit negative, if you have lots of constraints in that package, you maybe have 50 different logics that maybe can become a bit confusing, but typically this is not the biggest problem. And another problem is if the configuration logic changes, it's maybe not the best idea, let's say, to change the configuration logic globally, but then you have to go to each element and see if the element still has the same configuration or presence condition as before, or if this has changed. A recommendation here from our side, maybe start centrally. Yeah, have one dedicated package which constrains the, or contains the respective variation constraints. And if in case you have very large feature models or very large models, which are also then themselves are structured in order to cope the variability in the overall model, then maybe start to have dedicated variability packages, maybe one package on system level and then dedicated packages also on subsystem level. But typically start small. With this, I would like to stop this block here on variability patterns. As mentioned, there are more, for sure, more patterns that could be identified. With this, we already have now started to create a first catalog. That definitely would be good, either in the meeting or after the meeting, to get your feedback if this is helpful and what additional patterns maybe could be added. Good. With that, I would like to stop my part and hand over to my colleague Andreas Schäfer, who will guide you through the other parts. As mentioned before, I will join maybe in later, again at 3:30 or 4, depending on the time zone, and maybe to do a short wrap up. So you could also see on how to handle respective breaks. Good. So Andreas, the floor is yours.
Great. So then I will try to share my screen. I think you have to stop sharing your screen that I can start this. So that looks good. Okay, so after this, apart from Martin Becker, we want to further show you some examples we identified during the last years. so during the last years. One example here is the APE, the active phasing experiment. It was created in a cooperation between the ESO, European Southern Observatory, and the German chapter of the ENCOSI, the GFSE. And after that, we want to show you the example of a company, Beacon, we created for using this to show some examples in the variant modeling on software and system products. The APE example is based on a parallel observatory in Chile. Additionally, they have some challenges they wanted to face in this this analyzing system and creating the example by some issues with the positioning error or some the issues with the positioning of some mirrors. And here in this example, the system L was used to identify some common system properties and variation and variability properties. For this, the example itself is a really complex and is interdisciplinary system. It has a focus on software, but not that in the end. So it's also is focusing on a real system, and therefore they created a test laboratory and modeled this on the one hand side, and on the other hand side, they analyzed the mentioned observatory to see how they differ to each other. They are using the variant modeling methodology by Tim Wilkins, where you have variation points to mark the different core elements of the element, and furthermore they have more specialized variants like you see on the bottom of that screenshot where we focus on the laboratory example and the real world example, the observatory. In the model itself, this looks like that we have these this main model, which is here represented with this package. The model itself is filled with the main structure of the model, which is more to see as an yes, the generic model with the existing variation points, and then they extend the model with the different variations and their system contexts and the specific variants and their elements. Some other variant realization methodologies they used are the use of different profiles in their system model. So they include and import different profiles to have the specific stereotypes to model the information, like the SysMod profile by Wilkins and the specific SE2 profile for this example. Additionally, they import some catalogs and libraries to use predefined elements and properties to specify further specifica of the different systems. The content of the model here is well organized, though they structure these with specific packages where they strictly follow the same way in each level of the model. So that means that they have here the main content diagram with the main model element named APE structure. In there, for example, is one additional package, the internal methodology, which is followed by an more detailed organizational diagram where the internal elements are then following. These moving or walking through the model is followed for every package, and therefore it's more intuitive to walk through that model by analyzing the informations. Some guidelines which we identified or see in that example is that the organization of the model is necessary point you have to mention because of the complexity which is included by different variants shouldn't be multiplied by an not well organized model. So here we can or I want to show you some typical things like an recursive structuring of packages and elements is one point you should always mention, as well as the parts here that it's important to define which elements contains which informations. One recommendation is that you use packages only on the top level of a model, and in the lower level contexts and information are more focused on the structural diagrams for the different systems, like the description of the decomposition and the connection between blocks in block definition diagrams and internal block diagrams. Additionally to that, the use of libraries, as Martin Becker already described in the part before, this is also useful and helpful to reduce the amount of effort you put into your model, as well as create consistency between the different model elements. So after this short overview of the example from the API, we want to show you now the company Beacon. This company we created in our minds to have an example by our hand to show many different aspects out of the software and system modeling and variation creating. So the Beacon company in case has in our case has 80 employees, therefore 25 engineers, and is an well experienced in automation and home security market by existing for around 20 years. The example we use in this company is that they have some weather station systems based on some sensors, some basic more experience and pro sensors, as well as three types of weather station. The basic one, the more experienced one called Trendline, and as well as the sensor, the Pro. Additional to the weather stations, they newly integrated some smart apps, also two variants, the Lite and the Pro app. This what this looks like in our model is that we have some or that we here use some basic decomposition, where on the top level we have our root node, which represent the overall system with its different elements. So on left hand side we have some the generic element for the sensor. We have some elements which exist in every system, like the smart weather gateway and the smart weather actuator. And we have the generic element for the weather station itself and the app. As mentioned in the slide before, we have also integrated here the three types of weather station: the weather station basic, Trendline, and Pro. As with or by using the generalization relationship, as well as for the weather sensor with the three types or variants of the sensor and the app. So in this scenario, or in this example, we identified one sec. So, one second, I have some technical issues. Okay, I'm back. Sorry, there was a still active call on the other computer, which I need to close. So in this example, we identified a few scenarios for some variability creating points. Some of these are listed here, and in the next few slides, we want to focus on the three scenarios. The first one is that there is a new functionality for the Weather Station Connect Pro, which should create the ability to calculate real auto temperature. The second one is that the weather station trend line and the weather station pro should have an ozone sensor. Last of that is that in scenario 20, we have the change of the requirements for the weather station. And with the new requirements, the ambient temperature should go up to minus 50 degrees. So in this scenario, we have first of all the life cycle of the different variants which are visible here. So we have the basic trend the basic weather station which is extended by the trend line. That means that every property seen for the basic weather station is also included in the trend line variant and the pro variant. As well, we have changes over time. So in this example, we have here the temperature calculation, which is used in scenario number 6. We have integration of changes into the bigger weather stations, and we have different marks on the different changes to highlight if an property or if a functionality is added or bug fixed or changed in the possibility it works. Okay, so in scenario 2, we thought about that it would be nice to calculate the real outdoor temperature. The real outdoor temperature includes in our mind the wind chill, which follows that the temperature felt less than the thermometer is mentioned it. So what we have is that we need to have changes in the interfaces, because we need to have an additional space left for this information in the interface. So this is then in this example, this is a software change which is identified on the system level. And we need also to add the new functionality into the software. This is driven by the change of the internal connections, the internal information flows, and therefore we have an effect chain of changes we need to integrate into our model. The impact on the model is that we have changes in the block definition diagram, and the internal block definition, which is visible here, so that we have some alternative elements and some alternative properties, as well as in the parameter diagram. I'm sorry, this is the parameter diagram, of course. where it works the same on the internal block definition diagram, where we linked the elements with the respective connectors to an optional variation point, and with activating and deactivating these variant, these elements are integrated or deleted. Scenario four is about that you have already your system or the beacon has already their system, and they achieved a new customer, and the new customer needs some special sensors in our idea for some specific or with some specific requirements, because he want to include this in his type of weather station. So you need to add a new component, a new block, and properties for that. It's not only visible in the system context, but this is one of the main driver here. And here we have the variability type of an alternative or many alternatives, which needs to be able to be activated or deactivated. And especially in the block definition diagram, this this scenario is visible. So one step back in our example, we have here our main smart weather sensor. It has some typical elements which are part of the sensor, which are existing in every variant. And then we have these different additional sensors to represent the different types of sensors which are included in the sensor system. And the new customer want to have the new sensor, in this example, the ozone sensor. With that new sensor, it follows that that you need a new additional elements, here a new interface block to specify the specific proxy port. And with one customer or one additional customers or true, this is a not so picky example, but with the time and the amount of following customers, this could be difficult to handle, because if every new customer want to have a new specific sensor, it follows into many sensors. In this example, we are using only 13 sensors with additional 13 interface blocks to specify their specific interfaces. And of course, we need to add these elements also to our block definition diagram. And how you see here, it already becomes complex only with 12 additional blocks for the specific additional sensors. And this is only an example. So in real world block definition diagrams, it would be more complex. Okay, our last scenario we want to show you in this presentation here is that we have an change in our environmental requirements. So beside the change of the requirement, we also add a new component and add new elements to the specific diagrams. We have changes driven by the element properties which changed and the behavior which is changing because of the type of example. Here we can use the alternatives or the optional variability realization mechanisms. It's still a hard word for me. And in our example, we used the requirement diagram to show the change by an optional part of the requirements and the change in an state machine, which we see on the right hand side. First, we have a state machine which didn't use the possibility to be able to operate in an ambient temperature of minus 50 degrees. And with the added variability, we add some functionalities with the possibility to heat the system. I know it's not that realistic example, but the idea here is that we want to have changes spread widely over our model, and with that idea of heating the sensor system, we integrated a lot of changes beside these tools, which I show you here. So these are the examples we wanted to show you in this presentation. The end or the summary of these examples are that we have evolving variabilities and use different mechanisms to integrate them, and therefore have different impacts on our architecture. So that you have to decide which, or that one thing we identified is that it's useful to decide which mechanism is useful for which variability or for which for which part of which variability. Like seen here on the lower level, which is not useful to have something which is connected widely over the diagram to one element, and the main information you want to show on the diagram is hidden by many connectors in this example. One possibility is to think about the possibility of the module replacement in case of an open variability. So we use different specializations of of the elements and use an generalization relationship to integrate them indirectly into the model, which also reduce the amount of connectors and raise the the understandability of the diagram. Okay, so the next few slides were to presented by Martin Becker. So my question to you is it okay to step into a 10-minute break? And after that, Martin Becker will be back and finish the presentation. Yes, this is the right one.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, please excuse that I have to be off a bit of this tutorial for some time. Now in this part, the point would be that we have a look on what kind of mechanisms have we talked about and what are the respective tool capabilities what you require. Since sometimes it's not that obvious what a company would demand once they have, let's say, chosen. For instance, we want to use module replacement or this annotation or some other sophisticated approach. And therefore, the point would be we have analyzed what are required tool capabilities. For instance, if we would do a kind of managed cloning, so we are aware of what parts in the different system models were copied, pasted between different tools, or if we have kind of product line approach, in that sense that we use some inclusion of libraries or the exchange of modules, or to some extent also identify what are variation points and automate this. And finally, the production line, completely automated variation points everywhere. We have some logics quite close to the variation points, and based on the feature configuration, we can automatically derive respective instances. So here in this list, we provided an overview on some capabilities, what we think, what we require. So the first one would be that we maybe have to annotate, provide additional information quite regarding variability in the models itself. So in SysML and UML, we have seen there's on the one hand side to embed constraints inside of the elements. The other thing could be that we use a node or a constraint block to provide additional annotations embedded there and link it then to the respective model elements. So these annotations we require, especially in production line and product line approaches, maybe in this managed cloning, it's not that required. Another capability is that we have some automated generation of variants. So if we have, for instance, the 150% approach and we have some annotation inside, it would be great if via the tool, like a preprocessor, get a customized model. This would mean either the tool supports such a kind of thing, or it does provide a respective automation API. For instance, the Enterprise Architect and also the other modeling tools, they provide an automation API. And with that, you, for instance, could query the elements which contain variability-related information and then do kind of processing. This could mean removal of stuff, like in the case of pure variance, but this could also mean the generation of newly new model content. If you maybe would like to follow more DSL-based approach, or also changing of certain model content. So there, the availability of a respective API is quite key. Another aspect would be validation of constraints like requires, so feature A requires feature B, or if you include this here in the variation point, then you must provide at a other point a respective implementation. So this would be especially of interest if you have this production line approach, so that you can formulate some constraints in the model, which then are respectively checked. If you follow managed cloning or more this modularization approaches, then it would be quite key that you have a clear branching, merging functionality, and also a comparing functionality, like a two or three way diff and maybe preview. This is especially relevant for managed cloning, for instance, or the this product line approach, where you want to explain or want to replace or understand changes, let's say, on a bigger level of granularity, maybe packages. Some cherry picking of more fine-grained customizations also could be required, for instance, if you do something more clone-based, that you somewhere have a repository of kind of feature patches, where you would say, I have my core model, and if the respective feature is selected, then I check it out of the repository, and this then goes into the model and does some fine-grained modifications by overloading existing content. Version control, of course, is quite key. Let's say in all of the approaches, an impact analysis, the impact of variation points on the different variants is of interest if you follow this, let's say, product line or production line approach, where you have some dedicated approach for variability. In general, regarding lifecycle management or change management, review and approval support is quite helpful. Then import-export capabilities that you, for instance, can have a certain module exported into the repository and import it back. That would be helpful if you have variation points more on the level of individual, let's say, packages, and in general, a kind of asset management, that you have a repository where you can keep different model variants and then query what are the, let's say, best possible ones that fit your current needs. This is especially of interest if you have some clones or if you follow a product line approach. So these are some tool capabilities, what we see in the different approaches, what could be helpful. And we wanted to know from you how you see that. What capabilities are missing there, or is the rating according to the respective tools somehow wrong? For time reasons, I would propose that we do this, that you do this while I'm continuing with the respective slides here, if you don't mind. that you could see, are there essential tool capabilities? Maybe especially Juha could answer this according to your experience in with MetaEdit. What would you see are additional features? What sound variability realization, especially in UML SysML models, would be helpful? For instance, model transformation or such kind of feature, which we have not listed in here. Good. Yeah, regarding the UML SysML modeling tools, we can say that there is a different support of these respective capabilities. As I've mentioned before, unfortunately, the enterprise architect does not support out of the box in most of the things very sound support. There are some other tools like the Cormeo modeler or Rhapsody out of the box can already do a bit more regarding this. I would propose for time reasons, we skip also the discussion regarding your experience, which of the tools are performing worse or less, since there is also a section on some guidelines, maybe when which approach overall could be followed. That was our landscape of the different approaches. Let's say from this ZF talk, they already had some first guidance on when the 150% approach is maybe better than more a compositional based approach based on some kind of modules. And this is what I dive a bit deeper in the following. If we have this annotation based approach, this 150% approach, we see if we have single views where we show all the possibilities in there, and these possibilities increase over time, then of course the complexity of that respective view raises, and with that the understandability decreases. Meaning, for instance, it would make sense to follow 150% approach in one diagram, so to say, if the commonality in the diagram still is the majority and the variability is the minor part. If everything in the diagram is changing, then it's typically too hard for the engineers to grasp, okay, what are the common things and how do they interrelate? So one first recommendation could be there, put things together in diagrams if the common aspect is still way the majority. Yeah, if we have maybe 60, 70, 80% in common. If we have a majority of variability on the diagrams, then it's better to split them and keep them separate. And this was also something where we started, maybe what are the limitations or where are the limitations of this annotation-based approach? So when it's maybe better to keep variants separate, and we simply called it, should I stay or should I go? In that sense, should I stay within the maximalist version where everything is added into one package, one view, maybe with some additional knowledge about dependency on features or decisions or whatsoever? Or is it sometimes better to say, okay, we clearly separate application specific parts out and they are in the model addressed in dedicated areas or packages, and the platform part is provided in other packages? Or if it sometimes is maybe even better for certain areas in the model to say, okay, this deviates and changes that often, it's maybe better to follow a kind of managed clone approach there. So some recommendations. When maybe to think a bit about to go to product line or managed cloning. When the variable part becomes significantly bigger than the common part. So the common part is no longer the majority. Variability makes sense if there's commonality. If there's no commonality, then it's better to split the things that you again have some commonality. When the layout of the diagram differs a lot, meaning like in the examples before, if you have a different allocation of functions and I move around one element and this changes a lot the layout of the diagram, then it's maybe better to say, okay, I have my model elements, I have different diagrams modeled which show the typical layouts, I select one of these and then let's say do the final customization. Also what makes this let's say maximalist model a bit hard is when variants are developed in parallel with some time offset. You cannot integrate everything right from the beginning in a common core, but one project maybe wants to be quite stable and it does not include a certain feature which is currently under development or under modeling. And with that, it's maybe better to say, okay, split it, have maybe a separate branch for this model without a feature, have maybe a separate branch where you add a new feature and then add it later on in the core, but once it's done, but keep the model variant, derive it once from the core, maybe keep some relations, but do not try to follow this 150% approach. What you also saw in the example, when we have variant drivers which have an open range, where new variant instances come in over time. Like in that beacon example, if you have a varying number of sensors and they come in again and again and again, it could mean that it overall pollutes your diagrams. Therefore, from the very beginning, identify variant drivers with an open range, yeah, where we have maybe alternatives or option sets where new things could be added over time. And then in the identify where they will have an influence and there take from the very beginning a deliberate decision on how to avoid that these new incoming variants pollute your diagrams or your model parts. What also could be considered then changes in the artifact cause significant downstream cost. For instance, you are somewhere in a regulated area you have maybe your model and now a new feature has to be added. If you add this, then you have to assure overall qualities for all the variants again and again. Then it's also maybe better maybe to have separate clones and then adopt the necessary changes between the clones. Then have one big model where if you add one change, new feature, it affects all the variants which could be generated from that. That were some guidelines overall what we considered, where we would say the 150% approach does not fly. I of course would be especially of interested from input from Juha, where he would say there the DSL approach is the right answer and maybe none of these approaches in here would work. In addition to these things, we showed also or created the first model of kind of diversified variation management, where we have, let's say, the different approaches. So separate clones with links, product line and production line, and had some influencing factors like how many products do you have, what you have to maintain, or how many of these products are customized in parallel, if you have respective tooling, if there's planning uncertainty and so on. And we interrelated this with the respective approaches, just in a qualitative manner to express what is maybe positive or negative influence of the respective parameter on the selection of the respective approach. I think this to some extent is also self-explaining, and please come back. For instance, if I have a low number of products, if this is maybe just one or two product variants, then investing in a variability management tool and some approach which maybe changes the organization into what something which is more reuse oriented would be maybe a way too big overhead, and therefore you would like to avoid that. Just to explain how this could be read. If you have a higher number, maybe more than five, then maybe such a more strategic reuse approach is bigger. And if you have a very high number of variants, then maybe also the production line could be considered. In the paper we present here at SPLC, and also in some previous works, we have already compared the different approaches like cloning, libraries, annotations, parametric model, along different factors. For instance, are the different variants independent from each other, or do they have to be developed together? The granularity of variation points, very fine grained, or is it just on a certain level? If open variation is supported, meaning can I easily add new variants for a variable feature? Are there explicit variation points which are easy to identify and understood? And the overall effort. And there we have also this interrelation of the of the different approaches, the mechanisms along these different decisions. So if you know from a kind of scoping of your variant drivers, what are the granularity of the variation points, or if you have to support lots of open variation, you could go back to this table and then get a kind of overview, maybe when it's better to clone something, or maybe when it's better to use a module replacement or these annotation-based approaches. We had as said in our paper in here, it's also described in more detail. If you want to have additional pointers why this is the case or not, you could also go back to the PhD of Thomas Patzke, was one of my former staff members who motivated also why this is the case in here. Exactly, this leads also a bit to the paper. Andreas will introduce this tomorrow afternoon. It's about variability realization. What we see also with some needs from industrial practice. Some of the contributions in here, what we see is that we, on the one hand side, transferred the knowledge what we have from the code level on the model level, and that we identified also what are these key principles what we require in the different mechanisms, and how this relates to respective tools. So please feel free to have also look at that and provide us with feedback if something was missing and so on. Good. A final thing maybe before closing for me would be, what are your recommendations? And to this end, we have also provided a short overview board in Miro. So first thing, where you maybe later on could also have a look, is what is helpful material along this topic, variability realization in UML, SysML. We have added some of our pre-existing work and also, for instance, the book from Sven Apel. It would be great, for instance, especially a question towards you and others who are knowledgeable in this area, maybe to add additional books, tools, standards, and so on, what you perceive as being helpful. And so I will jump over this in here. Let's come back here to the recommendation. So are there some kind of guidelines which you would like to share in addition to the ones we have shown before? Yeah, that's great that we have especially the input on where the DSL is better. Do we have from the industrial practitioners maybe also some kind of guidelines or impression in which situation, following what kind of approach is on the one hand side preferable or let's say counterproductive? Maybe this does not seem to be the case. Okay, I would, would you like to explain these two points?
Sure. So if there's a huge number of products, well, I mentioned the Nokia mobile phone that they were able to produce 150 models a year, but obviously someone creating, let's say, calendar application that would fit for all those 50 different models would be next to impossible. So therefore, there are cases where 150% model is not possible. Mm-hmm. There's so much variation that such a model would explode. Mm-hmm. So then it is divided somehow.
Okay.
And then the other approach is that quite often it's expected that the people master UML and SysML.
Mm-hmm.
And if we want to have external people, even marketing people or non-programmers, like in automotive, for instance, the control engineers to be involved, then if the language is something that they already know, it's close to their working, then it's easier. For example, we have some experiences, or we know that one company had made a language for HVAC systems, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, DSL.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, then the domain engineers can model, let's say, what is the pressure? Pressure is a concept in the modeling language.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. And then everybody who has been working in ventilation systems knows what is a pressure,
mm-hmm.
unlike a block with stereotype pressure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is also something what I see a bit in, let's say, these current feature-based approaches. We know terms and we know the interrelation between terms, but we do not know much more about the meaning of the term. So like you said, yeah, if there is something like pressure or which has some additional meaning where it creates some constraints. Currently, the models what we have, they know requires and excludes about terms, but without having a clear understanding what the term means. And I see also that there are some semantic approaches which also have some added values there. Yeah, okay. If you have additional recommendation, feel free to add them in here, either today or as mentioned, we will keep this board alive. So you can go there also at any point of time to see if there is more. What we maybe also will do is that we ask other experts to run through and share their opinions on this. And with that, maybe also have more insights there. I skip a bit about the things what we typically do these days. So it's about this initial planning, the scoping, and we have also dedicated tools then to analyze the impact of variability in some structures. Want to wrap this overall a bit up. So we have started with the point that MBSE, due to complexity, is becoming more relevant, that we know for the time being quite well how to handle variability and changes in text-based artifacts, but in models, that is maybe a different thing. And we should avoid to have an MBSE engineering crisis, so to say. We had some learning objectives so that you understand what are typical drivers and challenges for MBSE, have an understanding on what different variability management approaches exist for UML, SysML. There we are not complete. We showed some. There are for sure more. That you also have an understanding on required tool capabilities and some first guidance on how to select suitable practices and technology. Was the idea that you start to meet also people, interact with them. You have at least met some people in here. Also during the conference, feel free maybe to come back and connect to them, ask challenges. And as some key takeaway, there is a sound support of variant management in UML models, and it's a rising importance of having this. Lifecycle management capabilities like comparing changes, import, export of modules are becoming key, but the community, I think, has to learn how to do this best. The variability mechanisms on the model level seem to have similar properties than on the code level. Guidelines for the initial choice of mechanisms and also refactoring support seems to be needed. Not that sure if you have identified additional guidelines in here, or we have identified some. The evolution, of course, has to be considered. The one key message also in here in the this conference, where sometimes maybe we got the impression that 150% approach is the holy grail or the silver bullet. I would see this is not necessarily the best. We showed some situation where maybe the other things are a bit better. Would also be, let's say, good to have more input there, let's say from your side. We had a discussion there. And really also one recommendation, consider a modularization in the model as early as possible. So from the scoping, identify what are the variability drivers, where do they influence, what is the number of variants where you can make use of something, and then optimize the respective modularization and choose the respective approach wisely. Good, these were some takeaways. With that, we would wish you good luck. And in case of challenges, of course, come back, ask questions. We would be happy to help you or to discuss these matters with you. Thank you also for participating here in the event. It was a bit of a pity that we had less participants than last year, since we had there 20. And there we really had this exchange also between the people, which was quite good. And what would be helpful for us, if you could go back also to Miro, there is another board left. Let's say with some, what did you, maybe have you learned something new? What was interesting? What could we add? Maybe how could you make benefits of it? So what we would like to know is, what do you like in this tutorial, and where we maybe can change it? And as mentioned, for us, it's also the goal, for instance, to understand if the things what we presented is helpful. And on the other hand side, maybe after this tutorial, it would also be good if you are interested in somehow collaborating on the topic, simply contact us. That also would be something where we would like. Yeah, we have achieved a certain level in here. And if you have more input, if you want to provide example models, maybe in a different modeling language, that of course would be great if we could collaborate there somehow. Good. With this, I'd like to thank you, especially also for your flexibility with the timing, and then that you spend more time here together with us. Also in the name of Andreas, I wish you a great time here at SPLC, that you find also additional questions to your answers or demands, maybe identify new collaboration possibilities. And finally, I would like to thank, of course, also our sponsor,